Cantor Audio presents How to Succeed in Business Without Really Crying by Carol Leifer. Narrated by Carol Leifer. Introduction. When I was growing up, my only connection to show business was my Uncle Bernie, who was a writer for the game show Let's Make a Deal. Bernie and my Aunt Julie had a big house right by the ocean in Santa Monica, which seemed very exotic to a Long Islander. He was handsomely paid and always had great stories about the biz. He started out as an actor on Broadway. My grandma Becky even used to keep his written-by credit proudly framed on a table in her living room. To me, coming from a family of academics, this all seemed so mysterious and exciting, which raised one question in my mind. How exactly do I get into this racket? During my sophomore year of college, Bernie told me he had a big-time television producer friend in Manhattan who was looking for a gopher and that I should call the guy when I was home for the summer. Maybe he would hire me over the break. So I called and set up an appointment to meet this producer in New York City. But on the day of the meeting, extenuating circumstances reared their ugly head. First, I was 45 minutes late because the Long Island Railroad was delayed. Second, I hadn't written down what floor this producer's office was on or his company's name, which was not the same as his name. So I had to ask a few people in the building before I could find his office. Third, I arrived sopping wet because it was raining and I didn't bring an umbrella. When the producer called me in, we had what I thought was a nice enough meeting, during which I talked mostly about my college journey and my comedy aspirations. I left convinced I'd given a bang-up interview. Well, I must say, I was surprised a few days later when I heard that I hadn't gotten the job. What gives? I thought to myself. I'm the niece of this guy's good friend, Bernie Gould from California, besides the fact that I'm a delight and a pleasure. But when I look back on it now, I cringe. How clueless was I to think I'd be hired after showing up unforgivably late, vastly unprepared, and soaking wet to boot, not to mention dressed in a pair of jeans and a t-shirt. On top of all that, I don't think I asked the producer even a single question about himself or the job during the entire interview. My reference point had been college, where on a daily basis, it was all about me, me, me. And I never realized that looking for a job meant that I seriously had to reorient my entire perspective and behavior. This book you're listening to is the book I wish I'd had when I started out in my career. It's a collection of lessons I've learned since then, and although the industry I've persevered in happens to be the business of show, I believe those lessons are universal. Whether you've just embarked on the career you've always wanted or are already snarled in the struggle for success, I hope you'll find some useful counsel here. But this book isn't only for people looking for career advice. If you're curious about the entertainment business, if you're a fan of comedy, or if you're the type of person who enjoys a good yarn about a plucky Long Island gal who went after her dreams, then this is the book for you. You'll find funny stories and some poignant moments. And if my guidance can help just one reader avoid the career traps that I was unaware of, like if it's cloudy on the day of your job interview, be safe and bring an umbrella, well then, let's hope that person has a huge Twitter following and can spread the word about where she got such great advice. Part 1. How to handle yourself during the frenzied scramble for gainful employment.
Stand-up comedy is a cash business, Carol, and you can't beat cash.
Seymour Leifer, O.D. Chapter 1. And the hammy goes to... Find a job you love, and you'll never work a day in your life. So goes the saying, and no truer words were ever spoken, except maybe never eat at an empty restaurant. I feel lucky that even as a child, I knew I wanted to be in comedy. But there did come a day when I had to decide if I should stay on the comedy path or follow the road more traveled. As a child, growing up in East Williston on Long Island, New York, comedy was a natural interest for me. as finding a husband would have been, except that it held no appeal to me for the same reason there's no Mrs. Anderson Cooper. Comedy was revered in my house, as it is in many Jewish homes. Believe me, it's a long tradition of my tribe. Humor makes a great counterbalance to a history of persecution. And my late father, who was an optometrist named Seymour, how perfect is that, remains the funniest person I've ever known. I have yet to meet a pro who tells a joke better than he did. And he taught us well, my pop. Living in our household was the best comedy education anyone could have. My parents constantly played the popular comedy records. Yes, kids, I did say records, of the time. The 2,000-Year-Old Man by Mel Brooks and Carl Reiner. Alan Sherman's My Son, the Nut, which included the hit Hello Mutta, Hello Fada. The First Family by Vaughn Meader. Various records by Mickey Katz. Joel Grey's father, who was a vaudeville performer. And the list goes on and on. But especially The 2,000-Year-Old Man, which we could recite line for line as it played. Nectarines, half a peach, half a plum, it's a hell of a fruit. My family and I were lip-syncing long before Britney Spears was born. My dad would always call us all down from our rooms when the great comedians appeared on The Ed Sullivan Show. I watched the best. Jackie Mason, Rodney Dangerfield, whose HBO Young Comedian special I would later appear on, a young George Carlin, Jackie Vernon, comedy kings of their time. And to this day, I can still remember the laughs that echoed in our family basement while we watched and listened to comedy. Sure, on The Sullivan Show, we occasionally had to sit through Slavic people wearing tights and spinning plates on broom handles, but it was worth it. I would put on shows in our basement and go around the neighborhood door to door selling tickets in the days when you could do that and not worry about getting your head chopped off. I went to sleepaway camp and enjoyed being considered the funny girl of summer. And I loved winning the camp's coveted Hammy Award, despite its non-kosher status. In my heart, the Hammy rivals any of the big-time awards I've received as an adult. As I got older, I became a serious fan of I Love Lucy, and I would watch reruns religiously every night. I came to know every episode and was a walking encyclopedia of the show. It was my first glimpse of sitcoms, and it left an indelible impression on me. In the comedy rooms I've worked in over the years, there seems to be a big dividing line regarding I Love Lucy. I tend to find that women and gay writers worship the show, while straight male writers don't usually dig it. Even when I became a cheerleader in high school, my proudest moment was when the sketch we wrote and performed was the hit of the annual Varsity Review. It was nice that we didn't have to spell out some jock's name while wearing spandex to get noticed. So it made sense that when I went to college in upstate New York, Seymour told me, "You can go to any school you like, Carol, as long as it's a state school," I would meet the guy who would forever change what I intended to do for a living. I was a theater major at Binghamton University, then named Harper College, which was about as practical as being a philosophy major, when I met Paul Reiser. He was in my dorm's theater group, Hinman Little Theater, and the funniest guy I had ever met, aside from my dad, of course. And Paul had a similar background to me. He was raised in New York City in the same type of comedy environment. I discovered I wasn't the only 19-year-old who could recite The 2,000-Year-Old Man by heart. We started dating, and Paul related his dream of becoming a stand-up comedian. During the summers, he would go to open mic nights at comedy clubs, which were just becoming popular in New York City. Places like The Comic Strip, Catch a Rising Star, and the granddaddy of them all, The Improvisation, a.k.a. The Improv. Keep in mind, this was the late 70s. The stand-up boom with everyone and their mother doing 5 minutes in front of a brick wall was still years away. When Paul first told me he was performing at nightclubs, I must admit I thought, who is this guy, Vic Damone? Okay, younger listeners, I'll just wait here while you Google Vic Damone. So one night, I watched Paul at his open mic audition at Catch a Rising Star, and I was dazzled. Paul was really good at it. He was a natural. I decided to give it a try. The scheduling was a simple process that remains in place to this day. You line up outside the club in the afternoon to get your number, and later that night, you go on according to the number you drew. It's what I've always loved about becoming a stand-up comic. That and not starting work until 8 p.m. It was, and remains, uncomplicated. Get a number, go on stage, and voila! You're doing stand-up comedy, my friend. The self-loathing, regrets, jealousy, there will be plenty of time for all that later. So I put together 5 minutes of my best assumption of a stand-up comedy set. Stuff like, Trident gum. Their slogan is, 4 out of 5 dentists recommend sugarless gum for their patients who chew gum. So who is this fifth guy? What's he recommending? Rock candy and jujubes? Not half bad. I still have the tape of my first 5 minutes, and when I hear it, I feel like I'm listening to my daughter. As fate would have it, the MC when Paul and I auditioned at the comic strip was an up-and-comer named Jerry Seinfeld. The MC at Catch a Rising Star when I auditioned there was another comic who'd been at it for a couple of years named Larry David. They both gave Paul and me the thumbs up, told us that we had passed the auditions, and that's how long I've known these guys, literally since my first day in show business. So now we arrive at what was, or at least should have been, my first adult career dilemma. I had passed the audition at both clubs, but I still had a year left of college in Binghamton. Paul was a year ahead of me and had already graduated. So do I go back to school and defer my dream for a year? Graduating with a degree in theater seems such an amorphous accomplishment, but the comedy clubs were giving me this real chance at starting in something new and exciting. In fact, I never even debated the question. I decided to transfer to Queens College in New York City, a very tough school, by the way. You needed a pen to get in. Finish my degree by day and learn how to become a stand-up comedian by night. To my surprise, my parents were immediately supportive. When I told my father that I'd passed the audition at the comic strip and wasn't sure about returning to college upstate, he swore, "Carol, you gotta strike while the iron's hot." Even writing this now, I'm floored by his advice. At the time, I was a college junior who wanted nothing more than to seize the opportunity. But now, as a parent, I can hardly believe how cool, calm, and convinced my father was at that moment. Maybe his certainty came from never getting to live his own comedy dream, and he saw the possibility in me. Who knows? But I will always treasure how he and my mother were unwavering in their support for me to chase my dream. At that point, I didn't think about what it would be like as a woman to enter the male-dominated field of comedy. It just never entered my mind. I attribute it to my upbringing. As far back as I can remember, my mother in particular instilled in me a fierce confidence, an assurance that I could do or be anything I put my mind to. What sex I was never entered the equation. Even to this day, when I'm challenged, I hear my mother's voice telling me to always believe in myself and trust my instincts. My path after that decision, of course, wasn't easy. It rarely is for a stand-up comic. You bomb. A lot. I've had sets in rooms so quiet a yoga class broke out. And you get heckled, which is unique to comedy. I've been to some operas and no one ever yells, "Hey, fat boy! Yeah, you! Basso! You blow!" But maybe it's because I've never been to an opera in Jersey. None of that mattered, though, because at the core of it all, I was just so happy doing what I love. I still perform at clubs around L.A. when I'm polishing up for a gig or trying out new material, and I don't earn a dime for it. Occasionally, they'll give you something to eat if you've killed and they've got a kitchen. But there's nothing better than standing on stage with a mic in your hand telling jokes. My love for it hasn't changed from the first day I stepped in front of an audience. Fortunately, my sense of fashion has, I hope. And by the way, here's a shout out to being young. That's not a small part of my story. There's no way to explain it other than this. You lose your balls as you get older. Reality sets in, and man, is that a dream killer. So for you listeners at the beginning of your careers, take advantage of being young and brash and stupid. I look back, and I can barely believe that I made such a bold decision to transfer schools and become a stand-up comedian without much thought. But that's the thing about passions. They tend to rule you. They're not hanging out at the punch bowl with rational thinking. One caveat. Despite the heckling and bombing, I always got a lot of positive feedback about being funny, as did most of my comedic pals. So I would caution you about pursuing a dream if you find that, along the way, you're the only one clapping. Anything is worth a shot, but comes a time when you need to realistically evaluate your abilities. So heed this advice. Find your true passion, even if it takes a little digging. Find the thing that's inside you, burning to get out. I've always loved the question, what would you attempt to do if you knew you could not fail? Hopefully it's not fly a stunt plane without lessons. Because the possibility of failure is the extinguisher that's always ready to douse your fire. Find work, doing what you love, and whatever noisy doubts and distractions come along, your passion's voice will always rise above the din. Go for it. Passion is an early riser. It will be out of bed and ready to work while indifference is still trying to get its pants on. Chapter 2. My boss was a dick, even when you got to know him. So I'm living the dream. I'm a stand-up comic working in the greatest city in the world, New York. Only problem, money. I was making a cool $5 a night, cab fare. A day job was a necessity so I could make my rent for a two-bedroom, fourth-floor walk-up on Lexington Avenue, splitting the $450 a month rent with my roommate, Jim, a buddy from college who is still my friend to this day. At first, I tried waitressing at the comic strip, which seemed logical. I was working there already anyway. But that turned out to be a disaster. Serving customers while trying to entertain them on stage was risky business, as I soon found out. The deadbeats figure out quickly that when their waitress is doing her set, it's a good time to skip out on the check. One night, as I was sharing my nightmare waitressing stories with the table of customers, also maybe not the brightest idea, one of them told me about a job opening she had heard about. A private eye was looking for a secretary. My eyes lit up, either out of excitement or because another of my tables looked like they were getting ready to bolt. I can't remember which. She gave me a number to call, and I scheduled an interview for the next day at Foresight Security on 7th Avenue. I swear, I couldn't sleep that night. Visions of 1930s black-and-white detective movies dancing in my head. Would the dick be wearing a fedora and call me doll? Would I soon be the gal packing heat during the day while telling gags at night? Would I be tomorrow's New York Post headline after blindly heading to a job interview based on a tip from a woman who ordered a 7 and 7? My bubble burst the second I walked into the waiting room, which was filled to the brim with a collection of slouchy, slack-jawed gum snappers. I thought, is this defeated assortment really my competition for the gig? What gives? Turns out they were clients. The bulk of this company's business was administering polygraph tests to job applicants, from Burger King cashiers to hookers at escort services. I guess at both places, you want to make sure you get the order right. The opening was for a typist operating a dictaphone, a now old-fashioned device that was clearly named by a frustrated comedy writer. Basically, the job was transcribing polygraph results onto paper. Miss Marple, I would not be. I might have turned around and gone home, disappointed, but I sensed an opportunity. First, I was already a hell of a typist. Thank you, Mr. Feldman, my high school typing teacher. Then, during the interview with George, the boss, Private Eye, who was fedora-less, I might add, I raised the subject of possibly being creative with my hours. As a struggling comic, I was not yet getting the plum time slots at the club, 1:10 a.m., 1:30 a.m., etc. So I asked George how he would feel about my working 11 to 6 with no lunch break instead of 9 to 5. That way, I could get enough sleep when I got home from the club at night. George went for it. Still not exactly sure why, but I'm grateful to this day. If he had said no, I probably would have taken the job anyway, but I must admit that my mother's advice was ringing in my ears as I sat down for the interview. You don't ask, you don't get, Carol. An entire chapter in the big book of Jewish advice, I expect. I worked at Foresight, where your security is our concern, for almost 2 years until I was finally making barely enough to support myself with stand-up gigs alone. $100 from Baruch College for a nooner, which is not what it sounds like. It's a daytime show at the student union. The typing job was a lifesaver, thanks to the hours George let me work. But I must admit, I kind of enjoyed it. Nothing like a day's worth of mindless typing to clear the head for an evening of nightclub hijinks. Although I wish just once someone would have called me a dame with nice gams. Which is all a way of teeing up my advice for this chapter. Get creative with your job search. Whatever conventional means you use when seeking work, there are always ways to go off the grid, and I highly recommend that route. Where everybody zigs, zag. And vice versa, in deference to zagging. Here are 4 general principles to follow. Number 1. Get into the machine. Not surprisingly, a lot of people ask me how to get into writing for television. The stock answer is pretty basic. Learn how to write a spec script and then try to get an agent who could submit it for a job. But to me, that's lousy advice, because I think your odds of getting a job in that way as a novice are practically zero. It's just too big a mountain to climb with baby steps like that. So my recommendation, when people ask that question, is to try to get a job, any job, on a television show you love. There's not a show out there that doesn't have an extensive support staff of production assistants, PAs, and runners. It's low-paying work, you work crazy hours, and odds are good that at least one of the people in front of the camera will be a total psychopath. But that's not what matters in this equation. You're there, and that is priceless. I believe the same strategy will work in almost any business. Just get yourself on the premises as close to the action as possible in one of those grunt-level, assistant-gopher-type positions. You want to be someone who, like a production assistant, gets an insider's view of how the industry works. PAs do everything from getting more paper at Staples to going on Starbucks runs, sometimes 2 or 3 times a day, to waking an actor in his dressing room to taking the executive producer's dog to the groomer. Anything and everything, all the little stuff that the people stuck in that damn room writing all day have no time to do. I've sent PAs to the grocery store with the mandate, get at least 10 different types of candy bars and bring them back. We writers love our sugar and caffeine. So look for that entry-level job that allows you to be around the nucleus of the most influential employees, especially one in which you'll have the opportunities to do, and do well, what the career staffers shudder to do. Interacting with the staff is what it's all about, so being stuck in a mailroom or warehouse all day probably won't help you. A good head start is to apply for a college internship at your favorite show or business or wherever you're looking to work. I've seen so many people over the years climb the ranks starting as a lowly intern. For would-be television writers, I suggest you pick up a phone and call the main line of your dream show or the network the show is on and ask for information about its internship program. I suspect the direct approach will yield good results in other industries too. The intranet is busting with all this info, or at least clear.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.